Yeah, so I have renamed my talk. The topic given to me was approach to a cyanotic neonate, which I think is quite boring. So I have renamed it as let's simplify the cyanosis. We are going to examine the neonate, or we are going to have a stepwise approach, and there are only three steps involved. Firstly, you should know to pick up cyanosis. Second, you should know whether it's an emergency or not land with an emergency and then regret 6 hours back, why didn't I pick it up? And thirdly, to differentiate between a cardiac or a respiratory cause. Because you can't send a respiratory neonate to a cardiac center all the way to Bombay to get a cardiac surgery done and then find out that there was no cardiac lesion. Lastly, I'm going to give you an overview of some important cyanotic heart defects in a neonate. So this is an actual case. This is a 10 hours old neonate with a birth weight of 2.4 kilos cried after birth, was shifted to the NICU in lieu of hypoglycemia and jitteriness, and there was no other significant history. This is a neonate, looks quite pink and slightly dull. After the sugars were corrected, the neonate's examination was completely normal. There was no tachycardia, there was no tachypnea, low limb pulses were well felt. There was no murmur. Sugars were corrected, neonate was fine, feeding was established, and the baby was discharged. Did we miss anything? We forgot to take the saturations. So if you look closely, the baby doesn't appear completely cyanotic. We usually see such babies. There is mild bluish hue over the nails and the lips, but when we took the saturation, it was 91%. So is 91 normal for a 10 hours old neonate is the question. We usually discard this figure, saying we should not treat the numbers. But since clinically we can't pick up cyanosis, we have to pay more attention to these numbers. And there are normograms which tell us what is normal and what is abnormal saturation. So after 10 minutes of birth, most of the neonates have a saturation beyond 96. So we called for an echo, and the baby had tetralogy of Fallot with pulmonary atresia, a good size PDA because of which the saturations were maintained, and the baby was started on prostin followed by a BT shunt. So cyanosis can be difficult to identify to the naked eye, especially in a neonate. Acrocyanosis reduces our threshold of suspicion. All four limb saturation readings is a must, and all babies should have their saturation reading on the discharge paper. Just like you write birth weight, height, head circumference, it should be followed by saturation and a BP. If possible, all four limb BP is very well appreciated. So first step was to identify the cyanosis. Second, identifying if it's an emergency or not. When we land with an emergency, when the baby is in shock, we all know this is an emergency. But how do we pick up this emergency before the baby goes into shock? Tachycardia is a very, very sensitive indicator. If your baby's heart rate persistently remains above 150, 160, even when the baby is asleep or the baby is comfortable, there is something which is going on underlying. BP can be spuriously normal since we have lots of compensating mechanisms in our body to keep the BP up. Be sensitive to the color of the baby, peripheral temperature and the CRT. If you have blood gas available, even a venous lactate and a pH is very well enough. So a lactate more than 3 and there is no other cause for it, you should be sensitive to it. I wouldn't say that you should get an echo, but then you should be alert. You should not discharge the baby. There has to be a reason why the perfusion is on the lower side. And urine output in the last 4 hours post admission to the ICU. Now, how do I differentiate whether this is cardiac or non-cardiac? Now, this is something which was told to us as when we were students. That cardiac cyanosis, usually the neonate is quiet, he's not very distressed. The tachypnea is quiet, not much of indrawing. Cyanosis is usually out of proportion to tachypnea. So you have a neonate saturating somewhere around 80-82%, but he seems quite comfortable. So that is not going hand in hand. as compared to a respiratory causing unit where he's huffing and puffing and gasping, but the saturations are 90-89. So there is disproportion between the respiratory effort and the level of saturation. When you have this, it's usually cardiac. And definitely the saturation does not improve with oxygen. In non-cardiac cases, the unit is distressed, there is stress in drawing, oxygen improves saturation, and lastly we do the hyperoxia test. I think all of us know how to do the hyperoxia test. You put an art line or you take the sample pre-ductal, so usually the right upper limb. You take a baseline PO2 in your ABG, you give 10 minutes of oxygen, you can give it by hood, and then you repeat the ABG again and you see the jump of the PO2. So if you have a PO2 which is more than 200 after giving oxygen, you are sure that this is a respiratory cause and oxygen has helped. If you have a PO2 which persists below 100 despite giving oxygen, you know it is cardiac. But what happens to the gray area between 100 to 200? Suppose after giving oxygen the PO2 is somewhere around 160-180. In such cases you can't rule out cardiac, because there are certain conditions in cardiac which we call as high flow situations or high flow mixing lesions, which can improve a bit after giving oxygen because the PVR goes down or the pulmonary vascular resistance goes down. So the gray area also you should get a cardiac evaluation done. So all babies whose PO2 doesn't jump up to 200 after a hyperoxia test, you should get an echo done ideally. So this is the same thing which is tabulated, how to interpret the hyperoxia test. However, like I said, in some cyanotic heart defects with increased pulmonary flow, you can get a neonate with severe distress as well as cyanosis. So this is also a gray area, because I said that if you have a neonate who is severely distressed with cyanosis, it goes into respiratory. But there are certain lesions like transposition with a VST, like truncus, where you have increased pulmonary flow and the baby is in failure, plus the baby is cyanosed. So maybe this baby has a mixing lesion with an increased pulmonary flow. Before I go to the details of the heart structure, okay, so I'm going to run through the basics. So we have to revise our basics, which we learned in first MBBS. You have the IVC, the SVC, draining venous blood into the RA. RA opens into the right ventricle, which gives rise to the pulmonary artery. The deoxygenated blood reaches the lungs, where they get oxygen. It gets oxygenated. It is returned to the heart through the pulmonary veins. So these four are the pulmonary veins, which open into the left atrium, into the left ventricle and into the aorta, and this is how we see a normal heart on an echo. But this seems too simple. I'm going to show you a real heart and a real heart specimen. So this is a pediatric heart specimen, and this is how the heart lies in our body. This is the right ventricle, or the anterior chamber is the right ventricle, which is giving rise to the pulmonary artery. It bifurcates into two, carries blood to the lungs, gets oxygenated, and it is returned to the left atrium, which is posterior at the base of the heart. And we have this part, which is the left ventricle, which is also posterior, which is giving rise to the aorta. And this is the aorta. So this normal structure of the heart, the reason why I kept this video is that because I'm going to revise through the structural anomalies of the heart, and until and unless we know the normal heart structure, we are not going to know the abnormal. This video also goes ahead and shows us the insides of the heart, which I am not going to go into the details. It tells us where an ASD is located, where a VST is located. So if anybody is interested in knowing, you can take this video from. Yeah, so that was the normal heart structure. So if we really apply why a neonate is going to have cyanosis, there are very few reasons for cardiac cyanosis. Either there is reduced oxygenation or reduced flow to the lungs for oxygenation. So this part, there is something wrong with this part, that is pulmonary stenosis, pulmonary atresia, which will reduce oxygenation to the lungs. There can be right to left shunt, or there can be lesions which can increase the deoxygenated blood mixing with the oxygenated, or anomalous pulmonary veins, so the oxygenated blood is not reaching the heart and then to the system, or anomalous systemic veins, where the deoxygenated blood is not reaching the right side but in fact reaching the left side. So there are just four reasons in the heart why you can get cyanosis. And now we are going to see the same thing what we learned, we are going to apply to the structure of the heart. So common cyanotic heart defects which you will encounter in an unit. Five T's. You can remember T for Tanuja. A transposition of great artery, TOF, that is pulmonary stenosis or pulmonary atresia, total anomalous pulmonary venous connection or abnormalities in the pulmonary veins, like I just showed you, tricuspid atresia, truncus arteriosus, and some other complicated lesions. We are going to see just these four. Before we go into that, just remember that for most cyanotic heart defects, the saturation between 75 to 85% is well tolerated by a neonate. Why is it that? So that the neonate is so comfortable even with saturations of 75 to 85%. If you compare the same thing with the respiratory cause, we are so hyper and we panic when the saturations go below 88%. But when it's a cardiac cause for cyanosis, the neonates are pretty comfortable. The reason is that as long as the perfusion to the end organs is maintained, as long as the mean arterial BP or the blood pressure is maintained, for a cardiac cause, the neonates are comfortable because the fetal arterial saturations have always been around 40 to 60%. So that is something which you have to remember, that if you get a comfortable neonate with a saturation of 85%, do not panic. As long as the neonate is comfortable, you can remain comfortable. Okay, now we are going to try and diagnose these five lesions starting with T just with a clinical exam without an echo. We are going to have a clinical exam and an x-ray. So I'm going to tell you important pointers that will give you the diagnosis without an echo. Coming to tetralogy of Fallot, I am very much fascinated by the pathological specimens, so I am going to show you the pathological specimens. So this is a tetralogy Fallot specimen, wherein you know that in tetralogy of Fallot, you have a VSD, which is a defect in the interventricular septum. So this is the RV, this is the LV, this is the interventricular septum, and you have a VSD. And the cause for cyanosis is PS, that is reduced pulmonary flow. So the PS is in this area, this is the pulmonary artery, and you have a narrowing which may be either valvular or infundibular or whatever. From the outside, if you see, the pulmonary artery is usually smaller in size, the aorta is kind of big and it sits right in the middle. The same thing. So how will a tetralogy of Fallot with a PS neonate present to you? The neonate is going to be stable. Not much tachypneic. SATs will hover between 85 to 95%. Suppose you give him oxygen, it might just jump up by 2 or 3%. That is because it helps in pulmonary flow. And there will be a systolic murmur. This kind of x-ray which is told to us is usually not seen in a neonate. It takes time for the boot-shaped heart to be seen on the x-ray. It takes usually 6 months to a year for the boot-shaped heart to come on the x-ray. So x-ray, we are not very sure, but yes, what you can see is that the pulmonary plethora is quite reduced, or the lungs appear very black. Should we rush for such a neonate? We shouldn't, because what we do as cardiologists, we refer them for surgery between 3 to 6 months of age. But you have to confirm your diagnosis. You have clinically diagnosed this as a TOF with a PS. PS because there was a systolic murmur. So what happens is that because of this narrowing, whenever the blood runs through or the RV ejects into the pulmonary artery, it makes a noise. It's not the VSD which is making the noise, the PS is making the noise. So if you get a noise in a suspected case of cough, you know it is not pulmonary atresia, you know there is PS, and you can be comfortable with that. This is what a cough spectrum looks like. So this is the usual cough. As the narrowing increases, it becomes more emergent, because if this becomes completely atretic, then there is no antigrade flow, and then it becomes duct dependent situation. So if you have a tetralogy fellow with mild pulmonary stenosis, we are going to operate him beyond 6 months. So don't worry. If you have a classic tetralogy fellow with severe pulmonary stenosis, between 3 to 6 months. But if you have a tetralogy fellow with pulmonary atresia, then you cannot wait. And how do you identify this clinically? You will not get a murmur. That's all. You will not hear the antigrade flow going through the pulmonary artery. So pulmonary atresias are PDA dependent. RV outflow is atretic. PDA is the only source of pulmonary blood flow, and it is a duct dependent pulmonary circulation condition. You won't get a murmur. You will hear just a single second sound. Now I know what you're thinking. You are saying that in a neonate with 180 heart rate, I cannot identify which is the first and the second sound. How am I going to say which is the split of the second sound? So I personally, if you ask me, it's not a very reliable sign. But when we did a cardiology rotation, we were told to identify, we were given the stats, and we were told to identify whether the second sound is split or single. So it can be done, it's not very tough. If you keep on auscultating these neonates, you will hear the second sound very sharp. But in a normal kind of a neonate, you will hear the second sound a little bit muffled. So it's going to be same like the first and the second sound. But when the second sound gets single, it becomes sharper than the first sound. That is how we used to pick them up. But I don't expect a routine neonatologist or pediatrician to go through all this, and echo is more easier to get. Okay, saturations depend upon the PDA size that we know. Baby becomes symptomatic once the PDA starts closing. So you start with prostaglandin. Now this is a very, very controversial topic, because we know that prostaglandin is going to be life-saving, but still there is some kind of resistance in starting prostaglandin, and it should be whatever the sentence was. Okay, prostaglandin should be started in all cyanotic neonates. You just have to worry about the apnea, and I think you are very well versed in managing apnea rather than us cardiologists. So the only side effect of prostaglandin is apnea. You can start prostaglandin at very minimal doses, because what we have seen, it's an all or none kind of thing. If you remove the prostaglandin, the duct shuts off. If you start even 0.01 mics, it opens completely. So that is something very magical. And 0.01 mics does not cause apnea. If apnea has to occur, it usually occurs within the first 4 to 6 hours. So if you started prostaglandin, you can wait for 4 to 6 hours and then transfer the neonate to a cardiac unit. So that makes more sense. Rather than rushing, starting prostaglandin at 0.05 mics or whatever the higher dose, and then dealing with apnea while on transport. What do we do with these neonates? Now we have started doing PDA stenting in our unit. But the advantage of this is that we pass a stent through the femoral artery, and we pass it inside the PDA and we inflate so that the PDA remains patent. This neonate can be stretched up to 3 to 6 months for the second step of surgery. So BT shunts are also is also another approach, but it's an open heart surgery. I mean, it's an open sternum surgery. And you need to put the baby on bypass. It's a very long morbid course after BT shunt. PDA stenting, you can discharge the baby in 2 days. BT shunt, your baby lingers on for at least 2 to 3 weeks. So that was TOF. Now we go to TGA. So in transposition of great vessels, we have the aorta coming from the RV, and we have the pulmonary artery coming from the right ventricle. So this is the kind of situation that we are going to have. We are going to have deoxygenated blood coming into the right atrium, into the right ventricle, and going into the aorta back to the systemic circulation. The only way that the baby can survive is if we are going to have shunts or communication between these two systems. So if there's a PFO, you can have some amount of deoxygenated blood going to the LA, to the LV, to the PA for oxygenation. So for the TGA to survive, you need to have a good atrial shunt and as well as a good size PDA. This is something which we routinely do, known as balloon atrial septostomy, in which we try and pass a balloon through this PFO and we jerk it out so that this PFO increases in size and there is good mixing. This gives us time for the baby to undergo arterial switch. So we can stabilize the baby, do a septostomy, improve the saturation, and after 2 to 3 days, the baby can go for an arterial switch. Clinically, how do you identify a TGA? So in TOF, we said we're going to have a murmur and we may or may not have a good shaped heart. And if it's a atresia, the S2 is going to be single or whatever. In TGA, the clinical features will depend upon associated defects. So if you're going to have a VST over here, the saturations are going to be good because there's going to be good mixing and the baby will present with failure. So that is, if you are going to have a large VSD in a TGA, you will have good saturating baby with presence of failure. If you are going to have a PS with TGA, you will have significantly low saturations. And if you are going to have no VSD or an intact septum, then the saturations will depend upon the mixing between the PFO and the PDA. When to refer the baby for surgery? Immediately. Because firstly, the time of surgery is depending upon all these associated lesions. And that is an arena of a cardiologist. So if you have a baby diagnosed with a TGA, you should refer for surgery immediately. What we usually do is that if there is good mixing and if there is a large VSD, we control the failure first and then go for the arterial switch operation, say after 2 weeks. But if it's an intact septum, the baby goes immediately for surgery. Third lesion, TAPVC. So in TAPVC, we are having abnormalities of the pulmonary veins. In a normal heart, we said that the pulmonary veins are attached to the left atrium and they carry the pure blood into the left ventricle and to the systemic circulation. In TAPVC, you can have these pulmonary veins attached anywhere and everywhere apart from the left ventricle. So if you have the pulmonary veins attached to the SVC like this, it's a supracardiac TAPVC. If they are attached somewhere below the diaphragm, it's an infracardiac TAPVC. This is an emergency. If you have the pulmonary veins draining into the right atrium, it's a cardiac type of TAPVC. And then you can have something known as mixed, where some veins go here, some veins go there, so it's a haywire draining pulmonary veins. How do you identify this baby? If it's unobstructed, it can get missed because it presents something like an AST. Also, if it's unobstructed, it's not an emergency. So it's okay if you miss it in the first 2 weeks. But if it's obstructed and if you miss it, then it's a very big sin that you might do. You will have this kind of an X-ray in an obstructed TAPVC, which looks like a hyaline membrane disease X-ray. There is sort of a whiteout. And the baby will get sick within hours of birth. Hyaline membrane disease, to get this X-ray, it takes at least 6 hours to 8 hours for you to get such amount of white out lungs. But in TAPVC, obstructed TAPVC, this is, you will see this picture in 2 to 3 hours of birth. So if you have a hyaline membrane disease presenting earlier than expected, think about TAPVC. Second point, you have given the surfactant and you ventilated this baby, but the baby is still deteriorating. Again, you should think about TAPVC and not a hyaline membrane disease. You can imagine what is happening to the circulation. Deoxygenated blood to the pulmonary arteries, coming to the pulmonary veins and getting obstructed. So the only source of cardiac output is this small PFO. And if you're going to sit on that baby, given second dose of surfactant, third dose of surfactant, and ventilating and changing the ventilatory parameter, nothing is going to help unless you relieve this obstruction and you attach these veins back to their place. So it is a cardiac emergency and it needs immediate surgery. I'm just going to brush through. I'm not going to discuss these lesions. So we have something known as tricuspid atresia, where the tricuspid valve is atretic. And the blood goes through the PFO into the LV and a rudimentary RV, and it's the single left ventricle which is supporting both the circulations. You have something known as Epstein's. Now I'm discussing these lesions because they present in the neonatal age group and you might see such X-rays. In a tricuspid atresia, if you see a tricuspid atresia X-ray, it appears normal. Okay, there is nothing very startling about a hypospadroplasia X-ray. How do you identify them? Well, you need an echo. You can't really identify them clinically. Epstein's, you get such an X-ray. It appears as if there are no lungs. Such a huge cardiomegaly. Now, what is Epstein's? It's basically the tricuspid valve, which is supposed to be in this position, gets displaced way down here. And the RV is very small. And this whole chamber is a dilated right atrium. That is because this tricuspid valve is incompetent. And it keeps on regurgitating, even in the fetal life. So this right atrium keeps on enlarging. And this whole shadow is of the right atrium. So if you see your X-ray, this is a neonatal X-ray. This is actually Epstein's X-ray. Quite recently, say just a month back, you can't see the lungs in this. So till now, you have diagnosed TOF with PS, TOF with pulmonary atresia, TGAs, and Epstein's clinically, apart from tricuspid atresia, and even TAPVCV diagnosed clinically and the X-ray. So you don't need an echo. Okay, get that thing out of your head. Lastly, coming to truncus. So what is truncus? You don't have the right ventricular outflow tract. The pulmonary arteries are attached to a single trunk. So this is how it looks. You have the aorta and you have the pulmonary arteries, both attached to one trunk which is coming out of the heart, and you usually have a VST. So they present like a VST to you. This is the X-ray. Nothing very great about it, but what we were told is that if you see these shadows, these are of the branch piece. Normally they come a bit below. In truncus you get them a bit higher, but this is not a very sensitive marker. Surgically, how do you manage them? We kind of separate. We put an artificial outflow or tube to the pulmonary artery and we close the VST. So that was the approach to a cyanotic newborns. I'm going to just take you through our results. In the past 6 years, we have done 3,500 surgeries and 1,500 cath interventions with a mortality rate of around 5%. We are doing most of the complex heart surgeries. This is our PCICU, pediatric cardiac ICU. It's quite spacious. We have a step down for our mothers to take care post surgery of their babies. So these are some of our milestones. This is a post arterial switch in index to cardia. This is arterial switch in a 17 hours old baby. This is a TAPVC repair in a 1.5 kilo baby. We also have ECMO machine. We have put around 15 babies on ECMO. 60% of them have been for respiratory causes with ARDS and H1N1s. And this was a cardiac baby. Conclusion, all units should have the saturations monitored prior to discharge. When in doubt, start prostaglandin. It is life-saving. Neonates tolerate cardiac cyanosis up to 70%, so do not panic. Thank you.